So I'll now request Ramu Ramanathan to present his thoughts. I don't really think that Ramu Ramanathan needs an introduction, but just a small thing about him for those who may not know his personality. He is a Mumbai-based journalist, playwright, and poet. His published works include Three Sakina Manzil and Other Plays, which is a collection of 8 Indian plays in English, published by Orient Black Swan, and also a collection of poems titled My Encounters with a Peacock. One special feature that I would like to mention here of his plays is that he has written plays about forgotten histories and people on the margins, and thus earned the label political in the process, which is a good thing if you ask me. He is known to meticulously research his subject, and historical processes are the mainstay of his writing. And though political in its core, his work also beams with humor, and that is a little rare, I should say. And he is a keen observer of Marathi theater, particularly its throbbing underground scene. Ramanathan is also the editor Print Week India, and has been associated with the printing industry for the last 30 years. He pens a regular column in the Mumbai Mirror, which profiles the unsung heroes of Mumbai. I now request Ramu Ramanathan to present his thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhuri. Salaam. Considering this is a gathering of theatre people, I think we are very, very serious. And knowing Dr. Anade, I suspect he would very strongly disapprove of our behavior. One of the things he used to say is ki natak walon ka jo sammelan hota hai ya guftagu hoti hai wo raat ke baad hi shuru honi chahiye, ye din din mein in logon ke liye nahi, inki bas ki baat nahi hai. Anyway, two things. Very happy to be in Pune. I'm come back after a very, very long time, and the city has changed enormously. Ek to sab koi Hindi mein baat karta hai, koi Marathi mein baat karne wala nahi hai. Two reasons. One is, of course, it's a city of when I was very young, I come from a family of atheists, and it's, I think, a rare quality in this day and age. और जब मुझे पूछा गया कि तुम बड़े बन के कौन बनना चाहते हो, तो मैंने आगरकर का नाम लिया था. एंड एज अ रिजल्ट ऑफ विच आई थिंक अ लॉट ऑफ द फैमिली विल वाज लेफ्ट इन माय नेम, थिंकिंग ये लड़का बड़ा बन के कुछ अच्छा करेगा. द अदर रीजन इज अ मोर सीरियस रीजन इज आई एम वेरी ग्लैड टू हैव द प्रेजेंस ऑफ सतीश आलेकर. इज वन ऑफ माई फेवरेट प्लेयराइट्स, एंड इफ आई हैड नोन ही वाज इन द ऑडियंस, आई वुड हैव रिफ्यूज्ड टू स्पीक इन फ्रंट ऑफ हिम. आई एम वेरी ओवरऑल्ड बाय हिम. टू प्लेज ऑफ हिज विच आई थिंक हैव लेफ्ट अ डीप इंप्रेशन ऑन मी एंड माई generation is Mahanirvan and Begum Barve. And sometimes when one reads the plays of the other great playwrights around the planet, be it Nabugi, be it Foss, be it Shimul Fenish, I just feel our generation has let him down in terms of not celebrating his plays adequately all over the world. The energy and enthusiasm with which the Germans and the Norwegians, and for that matter even the Kenyans, have celebrated their own playwrights, I don't think we adequately do that to our greats, and I think shame on us for that. Very, very happy to be here because of Dr. Anade. It's only after he passed away, and as it happens, these are things one learns. I realized how big a person he was, and but he had this quality of making everybody just feel very comfortable with him. I had two memorable instances, or two memorable encounters with him. One was a series of essays which I had to edit, thanks to one of my publishing gurus, somebody by the name of Gauri Range. And this was something that Ranade Sahab had convened, and these essays had to be sort of meticulously rewritten, literally. So these were ethnographers, musicologists, and so on and so forth. And as it always happens, we have the tradition of the oral, so a lot of people spoke, but there was no coherence in this. And the amount of, the prodigious amount of energy that he poured in, we use these words a little carelessly, archiving, narrative, etc. Documentation, sorry, not narrative. But I realized that in his context and framework, what this meant, because he literally regurgitated all that material and contextualized it for us as citizens of the 20th and 21st century. I think that was an important lesson. One of the things that I had a memorable journey with him, and there's a small town in South Gujarat called Dharampur. It's about 200 odd kilometers away from Mumbai. And It's a princely state like many parts of Gujarat, and the Raja of Dharampur is a fairly enlightened person, and as a result of it, among other things, that town has a, you know, planetarium. But interestingly enough, it also has a music museum, because he used to collect stories and also simultaneously musical instruments. And so when I sort of mentioned this to Dr. Ranade, he was very enthusiastic. There were two towns I think he had gone to personally. One was Dharampur and other was the princely state of Gondal. In Dharampur, of course, he spent a lot of time, I think almost 3 days in, and it's a town with a population of not more than 5,000 people. And thankfully, it's documented. There's a small little book which is published, of course, in Gujarati, which he sort of made sure that he collected all that material. But something very interesting happened. On our way back to Mumbai, we went to Valsad and to have our meal and then sort of return to Mumbai. And Valsad, for those of you who don't know, is the town of three great people. One is Morarji Desai, the other is Nirupa Roy, who was spotted selling flowers over there on the station and then became Nirupa Roy. And the third is Freddie Mercury, the musician who sang in the Queen, the rock band. And so, you know, I sort of mentioned this to him, and then while sort of talking about Freddie Mercury, I said that, you know, it's very interesting, he's got a very funny face because his jaw is sort of distorted. And then there was a long silence, which is very unlike Dr. Ranade, and after about 7 minutes or 8 minutes, he retorted and he said, there's a reason why that jaw is like that, because it gives him 5 octaves. And he's able to do those 5 octaves, which I think is the reason why he's retained that the way it is. And that's when I realized that, you know, in all that banality and mundaneness, he was able to also have meaningful conversation. So salam to him. There was another, and I'll come to the point why we are gathered here. I've jotted this down because I have some notes of conversations that I've had with him. So we used to meet in his home in Sahitya Savas, there's a few handful of theatre people, and one of the texts I think which we had sort of tried to discuss was Natya Shastra, and he did not have a lot of time and patience for you know, things which had no relevance and meaning or did not resonate in today's century. So he used to say to a large extent that about 30 to 40% of the Natya Shastra is useful to us. A lot of it is otherwise very, very descriptive. So I, thanks to this conference, I just pulled out something that he had said. So I'll just read that out. So vis-a-vis the Natya Shastra, I think two things that happened. One was he introduced us to this text through Abhinav Gupta, and of course later through Acharya Kuntak, and to understand this whole notion of Indian aesthetics and all of that. But with regards to Natya Shastra, he made, I think, 3 points which was very useful to me in terms of my own understanding of theatre. So of course it's fairly simple, and he said that the Rupak, which is the text, basically consists of three elements, and this is what as a theatre person is the crux of it, and this is what you must sort of keep in mind. The first is of course the Kathavastu, which is the plot. The second is the Neta, which is the characterization of, and you know, the characters who inhibit this plot. And third is the Rasa, which is what as a playwright, what is sort of, you know, beneficial to you, what is the effect the play is going to have in performance. And then the fourth thing he mentioned was Itri Vitra, which he says, what does, that the plot itself consists and reveals itself very slowly and sustains itself to the praja. So this is the narrative, and it is the narrative that makes a great play. He says any playwright, any mediocre, ordinary playwright can write a play with these three elements, but it's a great playwright who can write a plot with a narrative. And the narrative is what determines the great performances, be it Bahas, be it, you know, later Mudalarakshas and so on. The great texts have been determined by this, and I think that has been a lesson that has sort of stayed to me. And curiously enough, the reason I'm mentioning, and I'm starting with this specifically, and then I'll come to Mumbai city, is that day before, I think the second most powerful man in the country made a speech, this is Doval, and he was talking about India 2030, and he used the word narrative about 33 times. And he spoke about how we have to slowly build the narrative and sustain the narrative. He said the Kathavastu does not matter, the Neta does not matter, and neither does the rasa theory matter. What remains, and most important for all in 1.4 billion Indians, is this narrative. So the narrative is what everybody is focusing on, be it Abhineta, be it Neta. I'm going to focus on Mumbai. That's what I know about. So I am the sum and total of various parts of this country. But I'm a child of Mumbai. There's a line in a Vishal Bharadwaj film, Mumbai Meri Mehbooba Hai. So I sort of adhere to that. I love her, I hate her simultaneously. I'm going to just, because of time constraints, basically focus on three aspects. One is language, because I think as playwrights, that's something that we all believe very passionately, and that is a thing that is sustaining us. We are a planet of 6,500 languages, and out of that, even as we sit here, every 30 days, one language vanishes. And the extraordinary thing that I find about Mumbai is the fact that it is a repository of all these living languages. That you walk around in the various streets and gullies of Mumbai and you hear spoken words which are otherwise not read but can be heard either on the streets or on the stage. So that is something that is enormous. The second thing is politics. As Agarkar said, that you may not be interested in politics, but politics is always interested in you. And the third is, of course, truth, which is a rare commodity. So languages I'm speaking of in the context of Mumbai, and of course I'm speaking in English, and it's interesting because the theatre of Mumbai also, if you date back to 18th century, and this is not my research, this is a research of two people who have done spectacular amount of study. One is Murali Ranganathan, he's a print historian. He's looked at the history of theatre through the components of print, so posters, handbills and so on and so forth, tickets, and the other is Arvind Ganachari. Both of them have spent enormous amounts of time actually studying A, text, and B, what has actually transpired, A, from 18th century Mumbai to 19th century. So languages has been the crux of it, and curiously enough, the first flourishing element of Mumbai's theatre has been in the South Mumbai part of what we call the Khetwadi Grant Road area, and essentially are 30 to 35 drama companies, amateur theatre companies performing plays only in English. So this was the nature of the beast, and then we shift to about 1850 and then what transpires post that. There is a map which all of us have seen. It's called Murphy's map, which is what Mumbai is shown as. So these are the seven islands of Mumbai, and it's a sort of of course, historic map, but it's also an iconographic map because it is what Mumbai is known as. So these are the seven islands that Mumbai was, and then as you know, it got reclaimed, etc. And then, of course, the city that we know about it. So two things, when you study the Murphy's map and you see the seven cities, one is you realize it's a very small, it's a very young city, unlike a whole lot of other cities in this country. It's a young city, it's a modern city, it's an urban city, and it's a cosmopolitan city. These are the sort of three aspects to the city. But much more interestingly, when you study that Murphy's map, you realize that 300 years ago or thereabouts, you had these seven islands, and today we find that the same thing is happening to Mumbai in 21st century, whatever the date is, to October of 2018. We have retreated to that position of seven islands. So you are actually retreated to a position where you have had seven linguistic ghettos. Earlier you had seven geographical and physical islands, and now you are sort of retreating to a position of seven linguistic. So you could be living all your life in Muhammad Ali Road and not knowing what's happening in Ghatkopar. You could be living all your life in Malabar Hill and not knowing what's happening in Juhu, and so on and so forth. There is a total and complete cultural disconnect that has happened in the city, and as a result of which there is a total, it has affected to some extent this whole quality of the spoken language in this thing in Mumbai. Even as we speak today, today and tomorrow, we have a fairly robust Malayalam theatre festival which is happening in, so you have a community called the Malayali Pravasi, and they are actually staging a series of plays which are modern, written by very young people below the age of 30 on themes that sort of resonate in whatever is transpiring in Kerala, and of course with the expats in either in Mumbai, Middle East, or in other parts of, and you have 14 of these plays which are being staged today and tomorrow in Kerala. Now the interesting and curious thing is that it will be, of course, houseful, it will be very well populated, but it will be essentially the Malayali community which is watching this sort of experience. It is not sort of connecting with outside. But there was a time when the same Malayali Pravasi community, if they had an program at the Sahitya Savas, at the Sahitya Vedi, which is a cultural hub, they used to meet once every Friday. You would have a Vaikam Mohammad Bashir, you would have a Vijayan who would be coming in to give a discourse on literature and trends. You would have a larger community of people who would be sitting and attending this. Right now it is all sort of becoming very, very inward looking. The Malayali Pravasi is again interesting because they are also sort of seeding various centers, because the Malayali community is not in one part of in Mumbai, so they are either in Navi Mumbai, they are in Dombivli, so different parts, but they have actually been fairly active in terms of raising relief funds for activity in Kerala during the floods. So that is the kind of work that they do. So there is theater and then there is this. Anyway, that is a separate story, but just quickly two, three things. One is that, as I mentioned, if you travel to various, so this whole thing about language, if you travel to various parts of Mumbai, and this is something that I keep saying, that like you have museums in different industries, you have a textile museum, you have an automobile museum, you have printing museums. For me, the reason why Mumbai becomes very important in this last 200, 300 years becomes very crucial is because it is a museum, but it's a museum and a living repository of words. And what, say, somebody like a Murli Ranganathan or what Arvind Ganachari and a whole lot of other people have contributed to this is the preservation of these words and these local syllables that you're there. A good example is this area in South Mumbai called Masjid Bandar. And there's a very tiny community there called Kachis. And it's, again, when we had gone there with Veerchand Dharamsi, he made us attentive to the fact, and this was a small tour that he had conducted with a few playwrights and theatre people in that. So there were about 16 to 17 of us who had gone there. And he made us attentive to the fact that there, within the Kachi community, you can hear about 11 different dialects. So you hear Khoja Kachi, you hear Bora Kachi, you hear Oswal, two types. You hear Lohana and so on and so forth. And not just that, just in that same proximity you have the Nagoris, then you have the Mathadis, and this is just a very tiny 2.5 square kilometer, very densely populated radius of Mumbai. What the point that he was trying to make was twofold, that there was a time when this suburb or this district actually contributed in terms of language to the city's theatres, and you could hear this in the various stages, whether it was Capital, whether it was Sahitya Sangh, whether it was any of the other theatres in that sort of radius. And somewhere this disconnect has happened, where again we have become more and more gentrified and we are becoming less attentive to this aspect of language. And he pointed out something interesting. He said that today one of the most popular playwrights in Mumbai, and I use the word playwright in quote unquote, is Manto. And Manto has written short stories in Urdu. And interestingly enough, he's probably, if you look at the number of playwrights that are being performed in Hindi, Urdu, Hindi, Hindustani, he is probably rated the most in terms of adaptation. And this is something that he finds very interesting, that here is someone who writes in a language which most theatre people in Mumbai cannot read, but you have the ability to translate that and adapt that on stage, and how the theatre can transcend something which has officially been clamped down upon. Again, innumerable such examples. I'll sort of not dwell too much of time on those aspects of it. Just two little stories. One is to do with Namdev Dasal when he was alive, and he had done this little exercise again. As some of you know, he was from this area near Nalbazar, Kamatipura. And Kamatipura, the area, was born essentially because you had these construction migrant workers coming in from Andhra, United Andhra in those days. And these are the people who basically constructed and erected the city of Mumbai. So the money and the resources were from elsewhere, but it was these Kamatis who were actually responsible for building what we have in this, in the city. So what Dasal did was, he took us again, not took us, but we were with him at that moment, and this was a very interesting, once every month the Kamathis used to meet in this ground, which is sort of famous in his poem Ganduba Kicha, and there's a huge playground over there, and you had about 300 to 350 of them seated in a circle, and the evening began with all of them crying. And the reason all of them used to cry was because they mourned anyone and everyone who has passed away, since the last 3 months since they had met. And then after that they laughed. This was in sort of honor of the people who were born and weddings and so on. And then after that, that gathering was essentially a mechanism to do money transfer. So those people who were going back to their villages, the money would be handed over to them and the money would go and there would be some food and drinks and so on. And then of course followed by singing songs, which is a collective gathering. And this would go on for about 12 hours, 14 hours. So it would start off in the evening and go on till morning. And then of course they would go back to their construction sites. And his question to us was, is this art? And how would you define it? What is the parameter in which they're gathering here every 2 months, 3 months, depending on the season in Mumbai, and then doing this little exercise. And what they sing, they all seem to know because it's part of a collective consciousness. And it was extraordinary because again, we would talk to a few of these people and we would realize that some of them had a database of almost, 6,000, 7,000 songs just there, but it's all oral memory. And that was again, I think, an important lesson for us. Anyway, the second thing that I'm trying to focus on is going to be politics and how sort of theater was sort of crucial to that. So small history of Mumbai. For me, the important period is around 1850 onwards. As some of you are aware, Vishnu Das Bhave arrives on the scene, and again, very, very interesting, and this is, there is documentary evidence of this, is a lot of the initial shows of his plays, when the tickets and the posters and the handbills were printed, they were not printed only in Marathi, they were printed in four languages, and that was the process of distribution. Even today, this, when I say ghettoization, what has happened is there's been a retreat from that position. So suddenly you will find advertisements of Marathi plays only in the Marathi newspapers, English plays only in the English newspapers. Surprisingly, Gujarati is the only language which is there, jo hum kehte hai, vyapak hai. Teen ya char newspapers mein they are spread all over. And this is again a very, very interesting theory because Ganesh Devi says that the only Indian language which will probably survive after 200 years is Gujarati, in spite of not having a cultural heritage in terms of a contemporary thing, no novel being written, great novel being written and so on, because A, it's a language of commerce, and therefore it has the, the propensity to sort of survive. Anyway, coming to politics. So like I said, Mumbai is an artificial city, it's a small city, it was created for certain geopolitical reasons by the British Empire. 1848 you had the revolution in Europe and that had an impact. We had the arrival of course of Bhave in the theatre circuit, but you also had of course Jyotiba Phule who contributes immensely. But simultaneously inside Mumbai three or four things happened: the arrival of the first university, arrival of the first textile mill, and more importantly arrival of enlightenment, European enlightenment as we have understood it. And this was of course a part of the British project of ensuring that the grand themes of enlightenment, rationality, etc. come here. Now two interesting things happen because of which Mumbai gets elevated. Number one is the American Civil War, and as you know that happened somewhere in the 1860s, and because of that you have a shortage of cotton thanks to what is transpiring in the mainland of America. And because of that shortage of cotton you suddenly require extra cotton. So you have the first round of textile mills being developed in Mumbai. So in 1850 you have the first mill and then you have the first round of textile mills being built, and with that the first round of influx of migrants coming in from everywhere. So essentially some of the sort of narratives that Dr. Shinde was mentioning about, so migrants from Konkan, migrants from Marathwada and so on and so forth. And then cut to 1914, you have World War I. And you have again, because of that, there is a shortage of cotton, but also a great deal of requirement, because obviously, you have nations at war, and because you have nations of war, there's a shortage of uniforms, equipment, all of that sort of thing. It requires again equipment, so you it requires again uniforms. So again, there is a huge amount of rebuilding process which starts, and again, the second round of textile mills being built in the city. So from one we go to somewhere around 140 to 150 textile mills, and again in a very small densely populated pocket of Mumbai. When the second round of mills are being built between 1914 to 1919, again there's an influx of migrants, and again you have, you know, the city sort of A, the population growing and so on. So this is the sort of big narrative. When the influx of migrants come in, two things happen. One is most of the people who arrive with their stories, with their songs, with their folklores, with their traditions. So that is one part of it. And the second part of thing is that they start becoming an integral part of the city. And, you know, today we boast of a city of about 20 million, out of which about almost 75% are migrants. So, you know, that is the nature of the beast. So this is the broad thing. What starts transpiring post 1857 specifically is the usage of the theater narrative in the grand, you know, political structure that we have in terms of A, combating the British colonial, and one of the reasons why we have the DPA being introduced around that period, and at its stringent most is because you have the, you know, Maharashtra is again a place where there is a lot of plays being performed, and Mumbai particularly becomes a kind of center point and a vantage point for this. So three things: one is they do not want any disruption of trade and commerce from there, no disturbance either on the mill sites or in the city, and so on and so forth. Secondly, they also want to ensure that you know, peace and calm is maintained. And third is that the production goes on as per requirement. Now, simultaneously, again, few things happen. 1885 is the formation of Indian National Congress, as most of you are aware. 1914 is again, 1914-1925 is Hindu Mahasabha, RSS. 1925 is again Communist Party of India. Now, what is very, very interesting is all these political outfits and formations are being formed in that narrow sort of block. So I told you Grant Road, Khetwadi, etc. The political offices and the formations are also transpiring in that entire area. So you have the British who are operating out of there with their naval disposition in the fort area. You have the political outfits, and you have about 50 to 100 of these theatre companies which are functioning. So you have the Congress House, and simultaneously you have Bangwadi next to it. You have Khetwadi on this side. You have, you know, what is now called Kamathipura, the old Nalbazar area, what is Pathebapura, etc. So that entire area is all happening simultaneously. When the Indian National Congress is born in 1885, as you know, it is a bunch of Bhadraloks who are sort of monitoring it and controlling it. And in 1890s or thereabouts, Tilak arrives on the scene, and he realizes that to have a genuinely powerful political outfit, A, two things are required. One is resources, and B is cadre. And if we continue to have meetings in small rooms like this, you know, we are basically talking to each other, we need to do mass mobilization. So, of course, you know, because he has Agarkar with him, they look at a model which is very Eurocentric, which is print. So you print and you outreach. But the problem with that is literacy. We are a nation at that time with a single-digit literacy rate. And so then he realized you need to populate the conversation in an audio form. And again, something extraordinary which they overhear, and I think it's an extension of what, you know, Sir was mentioning, that in India, everybody knows the Mahabharata. And the reason everybody knows the Mahabharata is because no one has read it, okay? And which is the reason why the stories can multiply constantly. And which is also the reason why they realize that this is a very good way to ensure that you have the goal of sort of Swaraj, but you use theater as a device to ensure that this seed is planted and then it multiplies. So as I was telling you, you have in Mumbai specifically, what happens is the mills are being born, and with each mill you have the entire mill structure and framework. Okay, so there are two, three things that are transpiring with that. One is it's a city which is for the first time shifting from a single shift system to a double shift to a triple shift because of the production requirements that are needed. Now these are essentially migrant workers who are coming to work and not attuned to doing industrial work. They are mainly, you know, landless labor, agrarian peasants and so on. How do you keep them inside the mill and get them to do the production work? So the Setias and the Marwadis who are actually created these mills slowly start ensuring there are entertainment hubs inside the mill. So if you again go to Lal Bagh and you go to any of these old areas where some of the old mill structures are still retained, you will find that the theatres are within the mill structure. So some of these shows that Sir was mentioning, you know, Dashavatar and you know, Tamasha and Khariboli and all that. All that is actually transpiring within. And the format is again very interesting. It is not at a prescribed time. It's always between two shifts. So you have one set of workers stepping out and another set of workers getting in, and the show there to ensure that they are retained. So that is the first functional part of it. And then, of course, this mechanism of utilizing A, the space around that. So Mumbai, you know, we have this joke about Mumbai that it's, this is an architecture friend of ours who talks about it, that it suffers from something called ESP, which is empty space phobia. Whenever we see any empty space, we do something about it. We will not leave it and let it be. And that is, and unfortunately, theater requires two things. One is language, as I mentioned earlier, and the second is space. So it is the ability to utilize this space which is sort of what manifests itself in this entire textile area. So two things happen. One is, as I mentioned, the usage of this entire mill mechanism framework that is there between the period of 1890 to about 1930, and I'll go on a little further. And then, of course, the famous Ganpati Mahotsav, which is, you know, during the 11 days, he realizes I can actually stage this play under the guise of doing mythological stories, but telling the, you know, telling the tale of colonialism and overthrowing the empire. Now, again, two things happen because of that. One is that when the plays are being performed there, it doesn't confine itself only to be, remain within the city. And these are, you know, we have innumerable such anecdotes. We've done some amount of mapping of these stories, that these workers return to their villages. So these stories that they're telling about the Indian National Congress is actually getting multiplied in the various, you know, villages, talukas, zillas of Maharashtra to start with, and of course Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and Haryana. I mean, you know, we were traveling in Jalandhar recently, and we found actually a trunk load of letters and documentation of workers who were actually working in Mumbai, who had traveled to Jalandhar, and these stories were retained over there of groups that had either traveled there or peasants were actually returned back to their village, and these stories. So the seeds were being planted into the city and they were being multiplied. Okay, so that's that. And there's again interesting, you know, things, this whole Indian habit of giving long speeches, for instance. So this was again something that was born and manifested itself because of these plays. So typically, if it's a play with two acts, three acts, four acts, what would essentially happen is that the first act would be performed, and then you would of course have the British officers in the front row doing the surveillance. They would step out in the interval, and while they stepped out, there would be Ashutosh monitoring them, saying that whether they're having their chai, batata vada, whatever. While they are downstairs, you would actually have a cadre from the Indian National Congress coming and giving essential information, that tomorrow's rally is here, these eight people have been arrested, this particular act has been deployed, and the moment they have done with their duties over there, so till such time the British officers were relieved, came up, till that time the speeches would go on. And sometimes the speeches would go on for an hour and a half, because the main thing was to utilize the audience in the auditorium. That you have a captive audience or whatever, 1500, 2000, how do you utilize them and how do you propagate these ideas? So that happened. Again, interesting, we were doing our research for Sahitya Sangh, and we are mapping, because in the downstairs, they have a lot of these curtains. And we were looking at some of their curtains, and we realized that even the stage curtains of the old Sangeet Natak plays were part of this messaging, of creating this narrative. So it was not just that there was a constant static on stage, but there were also multiple things happening. So if there is a curtain drop during an important scene, you had little messages being written on the curtain, and if you threw the light on it, only then was it visible. And then you could change that for another. So if you're doing a show in Indore, you change the message. If you're doing the show later in, you know, Bidar, or you're doing it in Gulbarga, then you change the curtain. And some of these curtains have been found, some of them had flaps, so that when the British officers were there, the flap would cover it, and when they were gone, the flap would be lifted, with just simple messaging. And then, again, this was the kind of thing they started doing when, the plays were on, is using the roads for the messaging and so on. So this was actually the strategy. Now something interesting starts happening in that period between 1914 to 1925, as I told you, political formations. And I think somewhere in all this, because I'm Mumbaikar and so on, but having studied this, I think it plays an important and vital role in that, is to understand this whole beast of what the Indian nation state is going to be. So all these political formations are there. As I told you, the Indian National Congress, RSS, Hindu Mahasabha, Communist Party of India, But something else is also transpiring. At that precise moment, Gandhiji arrives from this side, and 2 years later, Ambedkar arrives from that side. So you have in that small radius, and it's actually, if you take a compass and just do a 10 kilometer turnaround, you find all these elements over there who are deciding what is going to be the nature of this beast called India when it gets freedom. What is going to be the nature of political freedom? What is going to be the nature and framework of the constitution? Are we going to be a Hindu state? Are we going to be opting for state socialism? Are we going to go the communist way? Is it going to be the American model of private capital, etc.? These are the debates that are actually sort of transpiring in that very dense populated area of Mumbai, where you have migrants, you have mill workers, you have the British Navy on the one hand, and you have war on the other hand. And it's actually quite fascinating that if you study what happened between 1914 to 1919, that period, and you replace the dates, broadly the same narrative today. All right. The only difference is the theater was at the center of it in those years, and it was actually a glue that was ensuring that everything was sort of built around that. So again, just to sort of build on what I'm saying, 2-3 things. One is that, for instance, when Ambedkar returns, at that moment he's sort of described as probably he's come back from Colombia, and he's described as probably the sixth most intelligent man on the planet and so on. He actually sort of discards his entire economic theory and comes and looks at two things. One is political freedom and the issue of caste and inequality. And he comes to and starts to share his ideas in Mumbai in pockets of Baikala and so on and so forth. And the same thing happens, which happens to Agarkar earlier, where there is almost nobody in the audience. 4 people, 5 people and so on. And he realizes there is no process of political dissemination. And the framework is such that a person from the non-upper caste, upper class cannot be given sanctity in those spaces. So again, what does he do? And even today, the same module is being followed, where he deploys what Phule uses earlier, which is the Satyashodhak, and he invents something called the Ambedkari Jalsa. So it starts off with the performance, and then Ambedkar or one of the senior ideologues within the group come and make the presentation. And these are actually talks and conversations of serious discussion and discourse. And again, something interesting, we tend to look down, but something very, very interesting is happening simultaneously in Europe. 1917, October Revolution, you have this whole fraternity of workers, you have a playwright by the name of Brecht who arrives, and who realizes that these plays that we have of Ibsen and Chekhov are limited, and that if you have a working class which is ready to rule the planet, there is an importance and necessity to do something which is educate. And which is why in his plays you have this whole notion of that you educate and inform. Educate and inform and of course entertain. And the same model is being sort of followed over here. That you have Brecht in Europe doing the same thing, and of course it multiplies because of the strength of the Communist Party, and then the same thing over here. Now again interesting, 1925 onwards, Communist Party of India is born. World War I has a huge impact in Mumbai, which nobody talks about. It's one of the best kept secrets of pre-independence India. You have almost 1.5 million people literally go to the trenches of Flanders and die. So they're just literally sent there as sacrificial ghosts. These are unknown soldiers. Again, the same narrative. You do this for the nation and you need to send the jawans and you need to go and fight these battles. But who are these people? They're unknown peasants who don't have land. And which is one of the reasons why they're easy recruits for this battle over there. Now the interesting thing, if you read about the World War I, is the narrative stops over there in Europe in 1919, but the war carries on. The war carries on in Mesopotamia because the oil fields are there, and the battle is about the oil fields. And Indian soldiers are continuing to die up to 1922, 1923. So this is the bigger story. When they return, you obviously can imagine broken families and so many things. Again, the question of enlightenment. That how do you sort of ensure that this great army that has come now is better equipped to understand the situations in which they are living and inhabiting in Mumbai. So again, theater. And this time the plays become short one-act plays which are performed outside factory gates. So these would be plays 15 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes skits. And again, we were doing a little bit of a study. This is again, all this is very informal as everything else in India. That who are the most performed contemporary playwrights in this country? Of course, Shakespeare is at the top of the list, and then Brecht and so on. There's no Indian playwright in the first 10. And the first name that appears, at least in this part of India, is Badal Babu, Badal Sarkar. And the only reason why he is there in the list is because of his one-act plays. And the reason for that is this tradition that you have, that 1937-38 you have the Kamgar Rangbhumi and 150 textile mills which are performing these plays, competing with each other, and the culture, that sort of ethos that builds around that. And again, this thing of Mumbai, empty space phobia, you have to do everything very guerrilla, you have to perform in 15 minutes, 20 minutes, raise funds, resources, do the shows and then move on. So that whole mechanism that Bombay has in that sense is very, very built and very robust for the one act, which is sort of fits into that. So either you do it inside the mill gates, inside the, you know, BDD chawls and so on. So this is the broad story. It's like, you know, as I told Ashu that this is actually a 6-hour thing with lots and lots of photographs and documentation. But I think jaise kehte hain sankshep mein, this is what it is. The battle ultimately was when, you know, the founding fathers, and hats off to them, was that in 1947 when, you know, we got our independence and so on, the big debate, and which is why Bombay was at the center of it, is will, is that they dreamt and they hoped, whether it was Gandhi, whether it was Ambedkar, whether it was Randhiwe, Dange, you know, the others, is that will India go Bombay's way or will Bombay go India's way? That was the sort of biggest sort of, you know, what we call the dialectics of 1947. And there was a huge amount of expectation that India would actually transform itself to the Bombay method of, you know, this thing where we, so many things which are, you know, enshrined in the constitution are actually a part of a larger ethos. Today, of course, 100 years later, you see the retreat that has happened, and post-92-93, I think very significantly, Mumbai just shifted towards the rest of the country. And I think somewhere the role of theatre started diminishing in that, and I think that voice that it gave in terms of, you know, speaking out and the truth, that somewhere, I think, was subdued. So just end with two quick things. One is that and in today's time, I think what is happening in Mumbai is that a lot of silence, and in the past few years we're seeing some voices which are daring to speak, and I think it's important to speak because they feel that they can utter the truth, and because, you know, as Brecht says, that where else if not on the stage can you speak the truth? It's easy to do that. You see the publisher, if you want to publish a poem, you need to go to a publisher, you need to make a film, there is that entire distribution network. The stage that way is much more guerrilla, so the ability to speak the truth. And again, two great playwrights one refers to, one is Shaw, who says that every playwright or every writer is a terrorist, and the only thing is that instead of guns and AK-47s, words are his armory, and the words usually speak the truth. And of course, 100 years ago, George Bushnell said that it's all very fine to speak the truth, but the truth gets you killed. So.
I want to ask you a question that is kind of around, because that's what your talk spoke to me about, sort of theater as politics and theater as thematizing politics, and a little bit to perhaps talk about contemporary practice in Bombay with regard to that. Yes, Ramu, it was for you.
Yeah, okay. So quickly, two things. One is I'll just respond to the previous. So Mumbai, I'll just rattle out some numbers to give context, you see. And this whole process of exclusion, it I think also includes a little bit of what you had to ask, Zuleika. One is, so we claim that, and again there are some stats which may be erroneous, but we claim that on an average it's a city that has something like 1200 to 1500, depending on the season, shows per month. So this would essentially be plays in Marathi, Gujarati, Hindi, English, and to some extent in Kannada and in Malayalam. So that's that. And we have something like 35 to 40 halls, not auditoriums. Of course, some of them are better equipped and so on and so forth. So this is the bigger reality. And you of course have the box office and, you know, collection. A good Marathi play could collect anything between 1.5 lakh to 2 lakhs on the box office, and likewise Gujarati and so on. So this is the overall sort of what we call superstructure, which is prevalent in Mumbai. Now in all this, very interestingly enough, say for instance, even though we would sort of celebrate somebody like Ambedkar as the, you know, father of the Constitution of India. But if a group which has allegiance to any kind of Ambedkarite politics, it will not be given a date in any of these 40 auditoriums. Okay, that because of who controls these auditoriums, A, government of India or government of Maharashtra, or B, the trust that organized this. So essentially there is a process of exclusion. So someone was asking me, why do their performances always transpire in the bastis of Mankur, in Ghatkopar? Why is it always happening inside Dharavi? Why are these people always performing on the streets or outside BGD Chowl, and why are they never inside the auditorium? One simple reason is it's a process of exclusion, number one. And number two is that entire mechanism and framework of ticketed audience and an audience getting. So again, that whole process of negotiation, what is it? And the third is, of course, the manner in which they're using their plays as a tool for political instrument. What is that and how they sort of succeed in doing that? So, for instance, just to give you a sense, a typical show that, say for example, recently when there was a memorial at Ramabai in Ghatkopar, it was again a two-day thing. Two things happen. One is you have an audience of coming in and coming going out of almost in Mumbai around 5,500-6,000 who are watching these plays and who are sort of celebrating these groups. You had almost 45 to 50 groups that are performing. So this is of course all very good. But what is equally worrisome is that there are probably 50% of the audience is made up of plainclothes police people. Alright, who are sitting there and making notes and watching and sort of monitoring every single thing that is being spoken and said on stage, and who is in the audience. So the whole nature of discourse has completely got distorted in that sense, and obviously that is the nature that you see in Mumbai. So which is why you have the haves and the have-nots, and that distinction is very, very clear. And it was not so, I think, pre-1947, and of course even the early sort of 60s and 70s, the Ipta years, so to speak.
Hi Ramu, thanks for the fascinating discourse. So, a relatively new phenomenon in the past 10 years or so is the social media. How have they affected, with respect to Mumbai, the language, the politics, and it has its own narration, it has its own narrative, and it's asynchronous, it's constantly available to people. So it sort of offers a parallel to the narration in theater. In a way. So how have social media affected all that you said?
I think some groups use it effectively, and so again there's an interesting phenomena which is outside of these 38-40 auditoriums that I mentioned, the halls, is you have something like 50 to 60 small intimate spaces for audiences of 20s and 30s and those kind of things. So social media I think plays a very big role in those kind of spaces, where it could be a reading, it could be a, you know, staged performance for two, you know, with a cast of one or two, and then also you can very selectively look at a text which would probably be obscure and not as sort of conducive for a mainstream auditorium. So mainly I would call them laboratory, so it sort of works effectively over there. And then of course contrary wise you have some people who have built a very strong following either on Twitter or on Facebook, which they have sort of, you know, they do maybe 10 shows a year on stage, and then of course, you know, whether it is, and some big names that are there in Marathi who are, you know, have been successfully been able to do this. They would have followers of a lakh and a half, which is unheard of, you know, and a following of that nature, and you find how they use that. But then again, it's sort of, you know, very, very strong allegiance to a certain kind of ideology, and they are of course not sort of, you know, scared to voice that kind of thing. So two aspects to it. But I think urban young people in the age group of between 18 to 30, I think they're using it aggressively, and I think hats off to them for that.
In terms of a parallel to theatre, because there are some people who are engaged in the narration which is going on social media.
Sure.
And theatre is not an alternative for them. So has it affected in that sense, in terms of whatever theatre brings, in terms of language, in terms of politics, in terms of truth, as you say, how have you seen the effects of social media on the general population, which are sort of detrimental to theatre as well? So
I think two things are happening. One is, I mean, you know, and this is a bigger debate. It's not confines itself to theatre, but then the manner in which you have a certain kind of hegemony, and as a result of that, you find that certain stories are not being told and certain things are not being reported. So one very good example, I think, would be Aadhaar and the entire campaign that was run around Aadhaar. So you had one was what the, you know, the government agencies were sort of trying to do, and then of course the private companies which were sort of building up a narrative. So you had this whole thing that A, it's a beneficiary, and B, to what extent, and then the models and so on that they were talking about. Now what is not getting reported, A, was you know, the linkage, A, in what it was doing in terms of privacy and affecting privacy, but much more importantly, the beneficiaries of Aadhaar, the poorest of the poor or the destitute among them, those stories were very consciously not being allowed to come out. So I think in those cases, some of the campaigners, and you know, what happens is the Supreme Court, now of course there's a judgment where there is a possibility that those hearings will be made for available to all of us. But for example, otherwise those narratives of what was happening to Feriwalas, what was happening to, you know, schools in Jharkhand, in places like Sindri and so on, what was actually transpiring with those children over there because they were not getting their midday meals, because the Aadhaar linkage was not functional, or a whole lot of people who were on pension not getting their pensions on time, those stories are just being abandoned and, you know, dismissed as statistics, 0.2%, 0.4%. So that was a fairly vibrant kind of a thing. Then more recently, I think 2 years ago, there were again a bunch of young people from Nagpur, I think Desh Bhakti Yuva Manch, they're again an Ambedkarite Marxist group. They again have a, you know, community of almost 5,500-6,000 who work with them. So they have been doing a program around the Constitution Day. So they are all atheists, and they claim that, you know, we don't have a holiday of our own other than Independence Day and Republic Day. So 26 November is, as you know, Constitution Day. So again, two things happened with that. The same thing that, you know, both Gandhi and Ambedkar combated within 100 years ago is that what is this animal called Constitution of India? We all claim that it's, you know, something that gives us our fundamental rights. There are aspects to it which give us our remedies, but we somehow are not able to ensure that this reaches out to the poorest of the poorest and every single person. And there are two problems with the Constitution. A, it's an extremely difficult document to read. I mean, if I tell you, pick up the book and read Article 241, which is talking of whatever, you know, land ceiling for land acquisition, it is extremely difficult to grasp. And the second thing is that we are again dealing with a population where about 40-45% of the population are illiterate. How are they going to access this Constitution of India? So what they have been doing, this particular group, is that they have some strength in Eastern Maharashtra, is on that day for 24 hours they read the Constitution of India in the form of some of these, you know, like the Pawadas and so on. So they will be standing outside ST bus stops, railway stations, and their thing is that those words are resonating in the, you know, ears of common Indians who can hear it, and they understand that these are the rights that they are entitled to, that it is not something that they are asking as a favor. So this is going on, and I think they have used social media quite aggressively in spreading this message, that this is as valid a document as the Bhagavad Gita or a Holy Quran, and this is something you should be having in your house. So.
Yeah, I think we will have to stop there. I'm afraid I won't be able to take more questions because we have overstepped the timeline by 20 minutes. So I thank both the speakers for their wonderful presentations today, and they will be available, of course, to the audiences for further questions in the break. Thank you all.